Anyway, a very good afternoon to everyone here. Myself, Dr. Nand Kishor. I work as an associate professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering, MNNIT, Allahabad, Motiram Nehru National Institute of Technology. In fact, I am quite fortunate enough here to have a visit to Gujarat Technological University. In fact, I was invited to have the evolution of the master's and the PhD thesis work. And apart from the evolution of the M.Tech thesis and the PhD thesis work, I was also requested to have organized a workshop dedicated to my research work. So based on that, I selected one of my research topic that is on wide area monitoring system, mainly for to damp out the low frequency power oscillation that exists in the interconnected power system. So in fact, this part of the work which I'm going to present here, I will give you a brief introduction to what is the interarea oscillations, then what is wide area monitoring system, and then again finally switch over very quickly to the part of the work which was actually carried out by me as a Marie Curie researcher at Aalto University in Finland in the year 2012 and 13. So in fact, major part of the work was carried out by me actually. So that was, and again, so we had some results published in the paper in the international journal. So that I will give out here at the end. So starting with that, here we have the outline of the presentation. I will discuss what is the basics or the concepts involved in the power system stability. Then, because when we talk about the interarea oscillations, then we have to know what were the consequences that led to the blackout in the power system. And that I will discuss over and some of the major blackouts that took place in the worldwide that will be discussed. And then finally, the approach which we applied here for the controller design to damp out the oscillation. Now, if you refer to the power system stability, the basic definitions which we have it from IEEE SIGRE report, it says that it refers to the ability of the electrical power system if the system generator, because if you consider the interconnected systems, you will have a generator, then associated controllers for active power control, for reactive power control. For active power control, it will be through the governors, and again the generator being coupled to the turbine, or it may be the steam turbine or hydro turbine. Then again, for reactive power, that means to control the terminal voltage of the generator, you have your exciters part, you have your AVR, automatic voltage regulator part, right? So then again, you have the generators at the bus bar connected to the transmission network. Then again, there will be so many interconnected network and then feeding power to the load center point. So this is actually an interconnected system. So it refers to that the ability of the electrical power system at a given operating condition. Suppose the power being generated at 1000 megawatt, this is the initial operating condition, all right? And if you have a perturbation, let's say you have the load, depending upon the power consumption characteristics of the different consumers, the load demand, the load drawn by the different consumer, different sections of the community, that would vary. And thus, what you have actually a random variation in the load, perturbation in the load disturbance, it will be always experienced in the system. So in that case, if you have the power generation at 1000 megawatt and suddenly you have an increase in the power demand, and in that case the generator should be able to sufficiently meet the increase in the demand, because electrical power system energy, in fact, it cannot be stored, all right? Although it can be in a very small proportion in the terms of the battery and all, but not in a large volume or a large cap in terms of large power or energy, it cannot be stored. So if there is a change in the load demand, let's say from 1000 to 1100 megawatt, thus this sudden increase of 100 megawatt will cause a change in the operating condition. And in that case, if the system is stable, the change in the new operating condition, all right, to the new state of operating condition. So if the system is able to remain stable, then in fact, that means intact, then it will be stable. If for a new operating condition, the system is unstable, then it will refer to the power system instability. So that means if the power system at a given operating condition changes to new operating condition and remains stable, then it is the power system is stable. And again, it could be the disturbance could be of any form, not only in terms of the load disturbance, but even in terms of the fault type. So and again, and it has, remember one thing, all the state variables, system variables must remain intact. That means whatever the variation in the generator terminal voltage following the load disturbance, because the generator terminal voltage should be allowed, it is allowed to vary in the range of plus minus 10%. Same with the frequency deviation, it is allowed to vary in the range of plus minus 5%. So all the state variables that should be allowed to vary in a bounded range. So if it is that way, then the system integrity is preserved. If it is not, then the system will lose the synchronism, and then in fact the consequences will be observed. So it would, the consequences will be in terms of the instability. So this is what it refers, that if this integrity which we talk about, in this case the system must remain intact whether you consider undue tripping of the generator or the load. Because normally what we have, if you talk about the tripping of the generator, normally we have the under frequency relay use of that. So that's if the frequency deviation drops below plus minus 5% range, then in that case there is a use of under frequency relay. Then the same way there is a use of over frequency relay. That means if the frequency of the signal drops or increases on either on the sides plus minus 5%, that these relays would cause the tripping of the generator. Same way we have the under frequency load of cases also. So even in that case you have the relays, and that relays would cut out the load conditions. So thus in that case you normally have, if you want to avoid undue tripping of the generators, then in that case the system must remain intact. So in fact what is stability? That is the condition of equilibrium between the forces. In fact you have the power being fed and then you have the power being drawn. So that's between the two forces the system must remain intact, and that refers to the condition of equilibrium. And if it is not, then in that case the instability will cause, it will result, and well, that will cause, in fact, lead to a sustained imbalance between the forces and thereby the consequence of the blackouts. The same way, not only the disturbance in terms of the load variation, but it could be the fault. So any, I will discuss in one another slides, following slides, that whenever fault occurs, the generator, rotor angles, or the, even the frequency, it will fall out of step actually. So if you are not able to maintain the generator terminal voltage or the frequency within the limits, then that means the generator is falling out of step. So this is what we call it as. So that means the generators will either slow down or it will accelerate. So this is what we have here, whenever we have the disturbance, right? And if you are able to maintain the stability, that means this is, you have all the synchronous operation. All right, you have one grid here, another grid here, another grid here. That means these, the systems are interconnected. And if the system remains intact, the system is stable. Now, this is the one which I refer to. Now, if in case the system is unstable, then now just here, here we have one generator. Although it is a very simple form of the system connected, which you consider here, this generator is connected through a transmission network and connected to a infinite bus. All right. So this is actually referred as single machine infinite bus system, SMIB system. So in this case, if I consider a simulation or study how does the variation in the frequency would take place or the rotor angle oscillation would take place. So if I cause a three-phase fault here at the bus bar here, then what you find here, the speed. All right, it is referred in hertz or angular velocity or frequency. So you will find here that if the system is stable, then following the disturbance, as in the case of here three-phase fault, there would be a transient response, and thereafter, after a few seconds, the response, the signal of 50 hertz, that will settle down to the desired value of 50 hertz. But if the system is unstable, then in that case, what you find here that this frequency increases to a large value. So if now in this case, what you have actually, it is a over frequency. So thus you will have an over frequency relay, and that will cause the generators to get tripped. So this refers to the stability and instability. So in fact, same way, not only in terms of the variation in the frequency, same way you can have the variation of the rotor angles, and then again, there could be instability in the form of the voltage. So that we call it as voltage instability. So there could be a possibility that following a disturbance, you have a drop in the bus bar voltage. So that's the, in fact, we have a broad classification of power system stability in C. you have frequency stability, you have rotor angle stability, you have voltage stability. Then again, in terms of the time duration, what is the time duration involved for the stability? You have in seconds, milliseconds, and again for a longer duration. Then again, small signal stability, and then large signal disturbance and stability. So depending upon the amount of this instability, we have small signal and large signal, right? So now, in fact, if you consider the power system oscillations, that refers to the mainly the interarea oscillations problem. So in fact, this is what we call it as electromechanical, because in this form of the stability, it is the rotor angle deviation. I hope you know the angle delta, which we call it as. This refers to the angular separation between the MMF field, MMF of the generation current generator, and the resultant MMF. Yes, I hope this works. No, it's not working. Oh, fine, right? Thank you very much. So here we have now, this is what refers to the electromechanical oscillations, mainly the electrical rotor angle, because that's why it is referred as electromechanical, because the rotor angle variable is associated with this. And these oscillations could be because of damping, because if you remember, in the synchro generator we have the user damper windings. So if you do not have sufficient damping, then in that case such oscillations may be observed. Then again, the such oscillations could also be observed in the interconnected systems where you have small disturbances, but normally in those cases where you have a large amount of power flow through a weak line. So in that cases, depending upon what is the amount of the power exchange between the two areas, such oscillations may be observed. And it may be either due to the load change or amount of the power generation change. Then again, what is the characteristic of such oscillations? Normally they are in the range of 0.1 hertz to something around 2 hertz. And that's why they are actually referred as low frequency power oscillations. That means the variation of power oscillation, the frequency, that is of very low range. So normally for interconnected systems, it is in this range. Then this is what we call it as interarea oscillations. Now what I said, that for a highly loaded interconnections, it will be observed. And in these cases, it is what we see, that some of the generators, they would be oscillating. Suppose you have interconnected systems. This is area one. Let's say this is area two. For in our context, if you say about, let's say northern region and the western region. All right, so the northern region and the western region, they are connected to a 400 kV lines. So some of the generators in the northern region and some of the generators in the western region. So it is possible that these sets of the generators, they tend to oscillate against each other when we have the power flow from northern to western. But it is possible that when we have the power flow from western to northern, these such oscillations may not be observed. So only depending upon the magnitude of the power flow and then again the scenario, what is the direction of the power flow, such oscillations may be observed. So then again, what is the issues here, because they are very important. If you do not have sufficient level of damping, then this oscillation will be observed, and that with the what is the consequence? You will have a cascade outages. That means one generator getting tripped. Then because when generator gets tripped, that means there is a deficit in the power demand, right? Or power in the power generation. Then again, there will be another generator that will get tripped because of the insufficient load demand being met by the generator side. Then in that case, what will be one by one, there will be a series of the generators being tripped. And as a result, this leads to the what we call it as cascade outage of the generators. Then again, such oscillations, interarea oscillation, low frequency oscillations may also cause damage to the generators. Mainly it refers to the soft oscillations of the generator, as in the case of the steam turbine. This slide shows the basic what is interarea oscillations. Here we find this is the equivalent generator of area 1, this is the equivalent generator of area 2, and then again you have a power flow between the two areas through a transmission network. Let's say you have the power flow from area 2 to area 1, and then initial angle what you have here, it is 35 degree, and same way in this side of the generator it is 72 degree. And now you will observe that when you have a power flow of from area 2 to area 1, what you find here, the angle, all right, the respective angles of this generator, they tend to oscillate here, all right, around the final angle point. So that's, you have a oscillation around the 35 degree. Same way on this side, you have an oscillation of 72 degree. And thus, the power flow which you have here from area 2 to 1, this is the power flow, active power flow, and thus this there is a oscillation of 100 megawatt power, which is of in fact this is the magnitude of oscillation peak to peak value, and it tends to oscillate at of very low frequency here. So, right, this is what it refers to. That means when you have the power flow from area 2 to area 1, a 100 megawatt power oscillation takes place between the systems, and that this is what you have it actually call it as interarea oscillations in the system. Right, so here we have what are the some of the blackouts that took place in the system because of the different forms of the instability. The most old one you can say, the 1965 blackout, that was in northeastern of USA and the Ontario. And in this case, if you consider, there was a backup relay in near Ontario that caused the tripping of 230 kV line. And what there were in fact five lines. One of the line got tripped, and thereby decreasing the amount of the power, 375 megawatt, and as a result there was sequential tripping for the remaining. In fact, that means you have a five lines, parallel lines, and one of the backup relay that caused the tripping of one of the line, and as a result other remaining four lines, they got heavily loaded, and as a result it caused other generators to get lose the synchronism, and that was actually a transient we call it as angle instability. And then again within 7 seconds from the initial disturbance, right, the entire region was separated into different islands, or that means the entire area was separated out. And then as a result what happens, most of the generation and the load, then again this was due to the frequency instability. That means the initiation of the outage, generator outage, was due to the angle instability, and later on it moved to the frequency instability. All right. Same way, this is what. Then again, we have in 1972 frequency. Then you have you observe that in 1996, Western Northern American interconnected systems, that was mainly the voltage instability. And what you find here that the line here. There was a drop, all right. There was a, in fact, the controller did not operate well, and thus the terminal voltage, all right, it dropped to near about 300 volt. So as you find here that within 30 seconds something, there is a drop in the voltage from 550 kV to 300, and that was mainly, you can say, the voltage instability that led to the blackout. Then again, in 1996, in WSCC, again in this case, this is what it refers to, the 2800 megawatt of power. That is all. At this instance, there was some disturbance, and then the power oscillations took place. And then what you find here in this during this period, actually this is from 31 second to 74 second something. So during this period, there is an increase in the oscillations of power, interior power, and that. So thus this is the entire region, and thus you have actually 1, 2, 3, 4. So the entire area is split into four islands actually. Then again, similarly, you have blackouts in 1999 in Brazil. That was mainly due to the low frequency oscillation instability. And then again, if you consider another blackout, that was BC hydro bus voltage near Alberta land. Even in this case, if you observe here, this is actually the voltage instability form. So what you observe here that the voltage drops, all right, the voltage drops to near about, this is around 0.957 to near about 2.15. So that means the voltage drops, and then again it oscillates, all right. Then again, this is around 3 seconds to 8 seconds. Within 3 to 4 seconds, the voltage drops to 0.15 per unit. So, and this is another example for voltage instability. Then again, here you have in the British Columbia and Alberta, even in this case, the rotor angle oscillation between the generators located in Sundance and Camano, even in this case, the angle fall out of step and then causing the blackout. Same way, there had been another series of blackouts in the year 2003 and 4. You can say that in northeastern USA and Ontario, and that led to the loss of 63,000 megawatt, affecting 50 million people. Then again, some of the blackouts in the European continent, and in the year 2003, in the region of southern Sweden and East Denmark. In this case, again, affecting 400 million people with the power outage of 6,500 megawatt. Same way, then again, another blackout. In fact, after 5 days, again the blackout that took place in the Italy region part, and the power outage was around 50,000 megawatt and affecting 60 million people. Then again in 2004, again in the Australian states there has been some blackouts. Then again, these were the series of the blackouts that took place worldwide. Then again, in the recent ones which we have here in the Indian power system, that was on July 30 and July 31, 2012. So this is the entire region part which was in the under the blackout. So you find here that with northern part, eastern part, and northeastern region states. So these were the these are the complete region which was under blackout due to the instability in the power system. So that's in fact now, because now we have interconnected systems, and even in our Indian power systems, earlier we have a new India grid. In fact, apart from this part, because we have four regions that forms the new India grid, and then again this region, southern region, that forms the fifth region, actually fifth grid, regional grid. So in fact 2013 we had interconnection between them. So now we have a complete national grid actually. And if when we have such in the large geographically widespread interconnected network, then there must be some schemes to how to monitor the entire network, which is interconnected network. Then again, we have to monitor the some certain variables, power system variables, and apart from the monitoring, we have to, because we have to maintain the system intact in synchronism, and we have to have the power flow in other directions depending upon the load demand, and then again we want to maintain the system stability. So then thus in fact in the 1980s some Professor Patke, they had actually did some work in the area of phasor measurement units. So these are actually basically, you can say in a common man language, you can say these are the basically the sensors. They will actually measure the phasor angles of the voltage signals, of the current signals, and they will give you an information how does the voltage variation or the current signals, or does the frequency variation, or it can be translated into rotor angle variation. So thus with the use of the PMUs installed in the in fact we can have, because we can install it at a very low working voltage also, but as of now some of the part, northern part, and the phasor data concentrator in the northern region load dispatch center in located in Delhi, we have some of the initiations in the installation of the PMOs. All that, which is normally at 400 kV lines here. Then again, these interconnections it will be through the use of fiber or communication link. Then again, in the western region, there had been some initiation to have how to have the intelligent monitoring control using wide area measurements. So this is what it refers to. We have an interconnected network. As you can see here, this is more or less like a ring network, right? These are the some generators here. There are bus bars. Then again, some of the important lines, or at some of the important bus bars, right, we have the use of the PMOs. So these PMOs will send the information to a center, control center. So that means there will be a centralized control center which will receive the PMO signals, phasor signals, from all the bus bars. All right. So there will be a information exchange from this bus bar to the central part, then again from this part. In fact, normally, remember one thing, these PMOs, they would send the signal to the GPS satellite, that is time synchronized, to the center part. All right. So thus, with the important bus bars, information available at the control center, then we can able to have a enough level of monitoring in the interconnected systems and then apply the control strategy. So thus, there are in fact different challenges, strategies here. So some of them I have highlighted here, that because you have interconnected systems and the characteristics of one generator or the one of the number of the generators in an area, that would be entirely different from other areas actually. So thus you have actually a complex mode of instability, and again it becomes a global problem, because when you have interconnected and at centralized level, that becomes a global problem. And in fact this instability could be either rotor angle, voltage, or frequency. Then again, nowadays we have a deregulated environment where you have a large number of power companies, and these power companies would be feeding power to your interconnected network. So that's again, then that means they would, depending upon the bidding and all, so they would inject the amount of the power. So thus the line loading becomes very complex. How to monitor in those cases in the deregulated market environment? So that's there has to be some coordination required that or the monitoring required in the interconnected systems in the deregulated environment, and that could be another challenge if you want to have interconnected systems through the WAMS. Then now I come to the problem where my work was focused. So in this case, actually, I have considered one Australian model. Then again, I have designed a wide area controller that is at a centralized level using the PMU signals. But the concept was based on how to have the model identification. So first of all, because we do not know. In the interconnected systems, in our Indian power system, there could be more than 10,000 of the generators. All right, and thus it is not possible to model them. It is not possible to have the model developed for 10,000 of the generator. Let me tell you, if you are going to model one generator, now a simple generator could be modeled as a third order model, where you consider the terminal voltage, delta angle, and again your frequency signal. So this is represented as a third order model. Then again, if you go for further higher, you can have a fourth order model, you can have a fifth order model, and sixth order model. So sixth order model of a synchronous generator gives you enough information, and then the complete detailed modeling of a generator. Now each generator has the use of turbine. So that turbine is itself a different system, and again it can be modeled mathematically. So thus a six-order synchronous generator and the turbine, let's say two-order model, a three-order model. So that becomes, let's say, ninth-order model. Then again you have a governor model, let's say two-order model. So that becomes a 11th-order model, right? Then again you have your exciter model, right? Then again you have your automatic voltage regulator model. So that means as a whole, one generator has to be modeled at least of order, in fact, 12 to 13 order system. So now you have a 10,000 of generators. That means that 10,000 of generators multiplied by 11 state variables. So that will be the number of the state variables. And thus, it is very difficult to handle this many number of state variables when you have to do the controller design. So what we can do? Now we have the important generators, we have the important bus bars, we have the signals available through the PMU signals. So from there we can have the model identification and then begin on for the controller design. So that was the approach which we have applied here. So in fact, what we do actually, we obtain equivalent model. All right, so when we obtain equivalent model, that means you are reducing the entire network of reduced size in terms of the state variables. All right. So then again, that means fact there had been some studies related to how to obtain the equivalence mode of a large interconnected systems in the past. It was a coherency mode or mode evolution method. There had been quite many. So there is another technique that you can reduce. Let's say you have a 10,000 order of the model, and you can reduce by different model reduction technique. This is another way how you can obtain the equivalence of the model. Then another way is that you go for the model identification. And then I find it very much more pleasurable because here you can have the use of the PMU signals, right? Then again, this is what I refer to. In fact, here, because the Australian power system which we have here, southern eastern Australian power system, this power system actually has 14 number of the generators, and there are five areas here. Area 1 has only one generator, then area 2 had 1, 2 and 3 generators, and 4 generators. Then again in area 3 there are 2 generators, then you have area 4, there are 1, 2, 3, then lastly the fifth area, it has 1, 2, 3 generators. So overall there are 14 generators in this power system, and thus you can, depending upon the dynamics involved, I will discuss later on, we can divide the entire power system into different regions, or thus you can say the areas here. So in fact, we have done eigenvalue analysis for this. So what we find here that there are, in fact, I hope you know what is model analysis, eigenvalue analysis. So that means for a given operating conditions, we do the linearization, we obtain Jacobian matrix. So all that part was done. And then finally, looked into the what is the eigenvalues layouts. So what we find here that some of the mode, 1, 2, and 3, they are of very low frequency and have very low damping factor. And if you look, because when you consider the interarea oscillations, then we have to know which of the generator participates more dominantly to the interarea oscillation problem. So what we find here that the area, in the area 5, the PPS 5, that has the highest participation factor to the interarea oscillations. So in fact, if you look into that, in the area 5, this is the generator that dominates more to the interarea oscillation. All right, so that was obtained. Then again, in fact, you can obtain the participation factor either from the rotor angle signals or you can obtain by rotor speed signal. So in both the cases, it is the generator PPS5 that has the highest participation factor. Then again, if you look into this part, mode shape, so what you find here that the generators in area 5 and then again the generators in area 1, that means they are actually 180 degree phase shift to each other. All right, so this is the here you have one generator in area 1 and here you have all the generators of area 5, they are oscillating against the area 1. Same way you find here that generators in area 2 and the generators in area 4, they are oscillating against each other. That means they are actually 180 degree phase shift with respect to each other. Then in fact, because once if you want to go for model reduction, that may in fact, I mean not say the model reduction, but the equivalence of by model reduction or by model identification, then in fact, if you have to know what are the generators that are more dominant to the interarea oscillation problem, then again, how the generators are coherent to each other. So in fact, here based on the mutual information theory, we have obtained how the what is the information action between the signals of rotor angle or the rotor angle deviation. So based on that, we have obtained from the mutual information theory. As you find here that the MI of the generators in area 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1 here. Now what you find here that these they are of higher states. All right. So thus we can see that these sets of the generators, they are coherent to each other. These sets of the generator G12, G13, and G14, they are coherent to each other. So depending upon the mutual information, using the rotor speed signals and same way using the rotor angle signals, we can say that these sets of the generators in area 5, 4, 3, they are coherent to each other. Not only that, we can also confirm this form of the analysis from the time deviation response. So what you find here that rotor angle, rotor speed deviations, you can see here that the sum of the generators in area 1 and 3, they are overlapping each other. And if you consider the generators in area 2, they are of different with respect to area 1 and 3. And all the generators in area 2, they are exactly overlapping. And thus, you can see that these generators are coherent to each other. All the generators in area 4, 2, and so thus now we have actually, you have 14 sets of the generator. And depending upon your participation, mutual information, which was shown in this slide, then again, your time domain analysis from this part, we can come to know what are the generators in areas they are coherent to each other. So once we have the coherency between the generators identified, then you go for model identification. So in fact, there are again different techniques how we can obtain the model identification. One is the least square methods, then we have the instrumental variable methods. So there are some of the techniques that have been applied here for model identification. And then design the controller. So now this is the slide shows what is the approach being applied here. Now just say this is the generator, synchronous generator. You have an AVR, exciter and the AVR model. And you have also have conventional power system stabilizers. Right? Now this is in the area 1. Now you have these variables at the output. Right? Dial omega of area I and you have this will be at the Z theta. Then again this is sets of the generator in area J. That means now let's say that you have actually just here area 5 and area 3. So now this area generators in area 3 and area 5, they are interconnected by this tie line. Area 3 and area 1, they are interconnected by this tie line. Then again area 2 and area 1, they are connected by this tie line. So now then again area 4 and area 2, they are connected by this tie line. So now you can, what you can do based on the coherency, you can select one of the generator in all the three areas. You select one generator in area 4, one generator area 2, one generator from area 5, and one generator from area 3. to have the equivalence, right? So thus now you have area 4, one generator from area 4 and another generator from area 5, and thus you can have AI and AJ. And now what you will do from the controller, from the centralized controller scheme as shown here, now you just here, now all you have 14 generators based on the coherency. Now I select only one generator from each area. So you have one generator in area 1, then again you have one of the generator, that is BPS2, in area 2. There were other generators also, but based on the participation factor that we have computed, we have selected BPS2. Then again in area 3 we have selected one generator, then area 5 we have selected PPS5 generator, and in area 4 we have collected GPS4 generator. So thus now you have the entire 14 generator model is reduced to 5 generator model now, right? And now you have the signals of speed deviation and the active power deviation between the area 5 and area 3, because 5 was connected to 3, then 3 was connected to 1, 1 to 2, and then again 2 to 4. So now you have these signals, speed deviation and the power flow deviation between the lines, that could be as a PMU signals, and then you have your at a centralized level through the use of the GPS as time synchronized, you can have the monitoring and thereby design the controller at the top level. And then again, in fact, let me tell you, because when we have the signal signal being sent from the bus bar to the PMOs to the centralized level, there will be a delay actually. All that, that delay could be in the fraction of 10 millisecond. It has been observed that 10 millisecond, 15 millisecond, 20 millisecond delay takes place. So that part has to be also taken into account when you want to have the controller design melee. For monitoring purpose, the delay is not very important, but for controller design, it has a significance actually, right? So that's the first. What was the first step? Obtaining the coherency. Then again, in the second step, we have obtained one of the generator from each area, and then we consider the model to be equivalent model from each area as represented at this form. This is known as a state space variable form, where you have a matrix, then again you have a B matrix, because B matrix defines the control in input variable form. Then again you have a C matrix, delta rotor angle and the speed, then again you have D. Now what you go, so because you want the model identification, so you have to first of all excite the systems with some perturbations form of the signal. So what you can consider, you apply a certain disturbance, let's say in the mechanical turbine mechanical power to the system of this nature, and then obtain the variables, output variables. So then again finally you run the identification algorithm. Then you require also the validation of the identified model structure, all at using different performance indices, and then again finally you obtain the worms model at the centralized level. Then you go for speed deviation signals between the two, and then finally design the controller at this point. So in fact, thus coming back to the second step, so here we have a pseudo random binary signal being applied to the reference voltage signal. You can just see here. Here we have reference voltage signal and turbine mechanical power as an excited variable. So we have applied a state pseudo random signals here to the two state variable, and then what is the corresponding rotor angle deviations and the speed you can observe here. Then again, then at the third step, consider the model identification by applying the different techniques. So in fact, there are different identification techniques which have been applied here, and then the corresponding rotor angle, what is the actual one, and what is the identified state variable that could be observed here in terms of angle, speed for using this technique, then again for another technique which we have for a BPS2 generator. Same way we had done for all the 5 generators here which we have, then again their state variables being identified, and what is their performance index. I find here that is the index which we use for identification coefficient or determination, COD. As in this case, you observe the state variables perfectly coincide, and thus the magnitude value is very high here. We have another technique actually, unforeseen. So even in using this technique, you find here that in the previous slide, that unforeseen has the highest performance index as comparable to these two techniques for all the generators. Right. So this is the variations of the angle and the speed obtained by these generators. Then again, at the step four, we want to consider the model being identified for the worms. And now we have the speed deviation between the generators in area 2 and 3. Then again, between 2 and 4, 2 and 5. Then again, you may have the generators between 3 and 4, 3, 5, and 4, 5. So what is the variations of the deviation, difference of the signal actually, the speed difference between the generators, that we call it a dial omega ij. So what is the variation, you can have it here. Then again, this technique was applied, and you can find here that what is the variation of the rotor speed between 2 and 3, 2 and 4, 2 and 5, and so on. So what you find that the identified model was sufficiently able to replicate the exact dynamics of the speed deviation between the generators located in different areas, right? Then again, in fact, we have considered another set considering the input variable as mechanical turbine power as input and rotor angle, rotor speed as a difference. So these are the plots which were obtained for the identified model. Next we come to what is the, because the exact system has a mode, all right, which has the frequency, which has the damping. So once you have identified model at a worms level, the mode characteristic must be retained. If the mode characteristics of interarea is not retained in the identified model, then it's of no use to design the controller. So it is important that if you have identified the model, the mode characteristics, all right, it must be retained. It should be corresponding to the same frequency range and again with the same damping ratio. So for the different identified model between the state variables, the model properties were validated for the identified model here. Then again, next we go for different controller design techniques. So in fact, in this case, we have applied H infinity norm. So that was actually basically used to minimize the norm that was between the rotor speed deviation between 2 and 3 with the excitation from the turbine mechanical power of area 2. So what you find here that in this case, considering this turbine mechanical power as a disturbance, what you find, now here we have a conventional use of conventional power system stabilizer in the area 2, then again in area 3, and then when we have a H infinity controller design at worms level, then what is the deviation? In fact, in the rotor speed, you can observe here that it remains very low. So that means for a applied disturbance in the turbine mechanical power at different stages. In fact, a random step disturbance was applied at different points during the simulation, and we find yet that the rotor speed deviation between the generators in area 2 and 3, that remains very low. So the blue lines and the black lines characteristic, they show the rotor speed deviation when you use conventional power system stabilizer. And what is the effect of using worms as a controller design, right? Using H infinity approach, then their variation of rotor speed remains a minimum one. Then same way, we have it, because you could have a disturbance from the turbine mechanical power, you could also have a disturbance from, let's say, from the exciter side, AVR side. So that was also tested. So considering the dial change in the reference voltage of the generator 2, so their observations are here. You find that the variations of the controller design at worms level remains low here. Now, in fact, the zoom part, the zoom characteristic which we have here between 10 to 20 second between this part of the characteristic has been zoomed here. So you find that if you use conventional power system stabilizers in the two areas, what are their deviations? And if you use a worms controller, then what is the deviation? So that can be observed here. Then again, if you consider, then again, these are the actually time domain analysis. Then you go for frequency domain analysis. So what you find here that this flat curve, the flat curve of the frequency body plot, that suggests that the damping has been enhanced in the system and thus improving the response. Then in fact, same way, we have applied different control techniques, H infinity, H2, because we want to compare with the other control design techniques. So we have applied H2, then reciprocal or complex stability radius, and then spectral abscissa. Then again, in fact, what are the values? So we have obtained it here. Then in fact, that was the between the generators in area 2 and 3. Same way, because once we have designed the controller at centralized level, they should be sufficiently able to have the damping out the oscillations between the different areas. So with that, in that case, we tested the response of the controller when we want to have the entire area oscillators being damped up between the area 4 and 5. So thus, in that case, you can observe that those response obtained by worms, it remains low here. Right? Then this is the zoom part of this case study. You find here that the response by worms controller remained low. And thus, it gives you enough information that if you design a controller at a worms level, how effectively you can design to the controller to damp out the oscillations between any of the areas based on the model identified model. Then in fact, we have extended the work. Then again, we have applied different patterns of the disturbance. Because load is random, your generation, power generation could also be random. All right, sometimes you have 100 megawatt, sometimes you may have 1100 megawatt. So thus the generation and the demand, both are random. So in that case, you have to apply different form of the disturbance. So that was in that way, in that sense, in fact, we tested the response. And we find that same way between the generators 4 and 5, the response by worms controller was sufficient, had sufficiently damped out the oscillations. So finally, in fact, what we find here that the controller at the worms level, using the identified model from the speed difference signal between the two areas, it had damped out the oscillations here. And then, in fact, from this part, actually, in fact, here I have discussed the controller design at the worms level using the identified model. Same way, you can also go for a model reduction. You suppose, let's say, you have all the detailed information, you are able to develop the model, and then you go for equivalence model. So that means you do the model reduction. So for the same Australian power system, I did the model reduction and then designed the controller at the worms level. So that part I have not discussed here, but you can refer my paper, which is in the Journal of Electrical Power Energy Systems, that is by Elsevier, actually. So this part of the work was actually for due to sort of technique, model reduction based technique. Then the part of the work which I had presented just now, that was actually published in IIT GTD, IIT Institute of Engineering and Technology. You get the paper from IEEE Explore, actually. So that was IET Generation Transmission Distribution from IET. And it was published in 2014, and here this was in 2013. And these are the people, actually. Lisa was my supervisor in Aalto University. And Juka, he is also actually as a postdoctor at Aalto University. And Mats Larsson, he is actually working as a scientific officer in ABB in Switzerland. So these are the, and then again, Soumya Mohanty, he's my colleague at MNNIT. So these are the people who are involved in the work, right? And then finally, I welcome, if you have any queries related to the problem, then we can discuss here. I think I have completed well enough. We have some time left. You can, if you want to have more information, you can refer to the papers, actually, which we have here. It can be obtained. I hope if you have the access to the, because these journals are actually, you have to get the subscription of these journals. It's not a open source journals. All right, so you have to pay for it. So if these journals are accessible to you from your university or from your institute, then you can get these journals and refer them more in detail. Any questions? I mean, it may be good generalized one also. What is the wide area monitoring systems? How we are going to have it? Although at right now, we do not have any controller at centralized level. Let me tell you, people, even in Indian power systems, so there have been PMUs installed in the different regional gates, and we are able to monitor them, actually, right? But again, same way in the Europe, because I worked in the Nordic region, where you have the interconnection of Finland, Sweden, Norway, and the eastern part of the Denmark. So in fact, I worked on the Nordic grid power system also. So, and then did some analysis, and then thereby the controller design. But that part of the work, actually, I did not discuss here. The reason behind was that because whatever the research output that I obtained from the non-aggregate model, it is not publicly accessible actually. I cannot discuss the results to the public. So that was as a report and it is in the closed file. So I cannot, that's why I could not have it here in my presentation. But same way, even in the Nordic power systems, people are working on wide area monitoring systems. Same way in the USA and all, there had been a lot of scope, because if you want to go for a smart grid, so a smart grid means you need to have the information exchange between the consumer side and the centralized side, all at the grid side. And then that will be normally possible if you have the use of the PMOs. So that means WOMS is actually a part of the smart grid. Without PMOs, you cannot have a smart grid. All right, so there had been quite many projects there by the different power utilities from the where the PMOs have been installed at the important bus bars level. Normally, as of now, the important bus bar, when we say important transmission network, when I say that means 400 kV lines, 230 kV lines, they have been considered as the most suitable bus bars where the PMOs could be installed. But there have been some studies, research studies, where the people have, researchers have tried to focus what will be the best location for the PMOs, because that also depends upon, because the controller design depends upon what is the best observability of the signals and the controllability of the signals. So that's why based on that, people have worked on what could be the best point, best bus bar in the network where the PMOs should be installed. So there had been research in this direction. But then again, in fact, in the controller design, there had been the research by researchers, by the people in the last one decade. There had been so many work actually. But as of now, I'm not aware anywhere that where you have a centralized controller actually, right? There had been a use of the PMO signals and then centralized, feeding signal at a decentralized level, there had been, but not at a centralized level. All right, but maybe in the years to come, you will have the use of the PMO signals and then design a controller at a centralized level. That may be possibility here. If you want the system to be robust, if you want your system to be reliable enough, that means if you want your system to be secure enough to meet all the kinds of the disturbances, all the kinds of the scenarios in the load disturbances, the power generation or power flow directions in any form actually, that could be a possibility.
Right, any more?
No question. Okay then, thank you all, and right, I think we have the next presentation also. Thank you very much.